everybody. Welcome back to Coco and Dalts. We are real people bringing you real reviews of all the latest movies and TV shows that are streaming on Netflix, Amazon Prime, and Disney Plus. And this week, our real review is Away, the brand new released on September 4th streaming TV show on Netflix. I'm not Dalts.
And I'm not Coco. And it's number one right now on the trending on Netflix. And we're talking about Away. And you know what, Coco? I'm actually disappointed because the segue there, the natural segue there for you would have been...
Take it away, Dalt. Do you want to start over?
Yeah, let's start over.
Okay.
I'm not Coco.
And I'm not Dalt.
Oh, wait. Okay, so...
So, we haven't been drinking.
No, we haven't. Not much. So Away is a 10-episode original Netflix series. It's a dramatization of what would happen if we were to go to Mars.
What?
So a little bit of background here. This was inspired by a 2014 article in Esquire written by my very, very good friend, Chris Jones. Chris Jones being a Canadian writer. He's a fantastic writer, had written for Esquire many years, wrote for ESPN, wrote for me when I was working at ESPN. We're like this, and I'm crossing my fingers together. We're like buds. We're like totally really good friends.
Because all you Canadian writers know each other.
All Canadians know each other. Oh, that's true. Too. So his article in Esquire was, what would it take to go to Mars? And it was a very well-written article. I read it again recently. And it's not like, so Chris Jones is a guy who likes his poop humor. So the lead of the story is, how do you poop in space? So we won't go into that right now.
Yeah. I really don't want to know about that.
Right. But,
I walk dogs for a living, so I deal with enough poop on Earth.
So the story is, so it's 10 episodes of how we get to Mars and the trials and tribulations that this crew, who is five crew members, led by Hilary Swank, who's the American. There is Dr. Liu Wang, who is played by Vivian Wu. She is from China in the series. We've got Mark Ivaner playing Misha Popov, who is the Russian. We've got Ray Pathanka, playing Ram from India. And then we have Eto Asanado, who is from Ghana. He plays a doctor from Ghana via England. And these are the five crew members. And the 10 episodes are them essentially overcoming an obstacle each time. I don't know how we want to go from here because I have so much to say about this, Coco.
Take it away, Dalt.
So the first of all, Hilary Swank is the captain. She is a woman, obviously, who's in charge
well,
of this
mission.
Well,
if you've seen Boys Don't Cry,
well,
I don't
know. That's why I had to state that out front. And she is in charge. She is married to Josh Charles, who is he is an astronaut, but he had medical issues that prevented him from going through with this mission or going further on the mission than he did. They have a young daughter, and so their story is one of the main focuses of this movie. I don't want to be a jerk about this.
So, you do.
So
come
there,
on.
So there's two things here that I want to talk about with her character. First of all, she's the wishiest, washiest captain that I've ever seen of any commander. Like, we need some serious James T. Kirk here to just be like, come on, we're going to land on Mars, and that's the way we're going to do it. You know, like, I that was actually more Regis Philbin, I think, than James T. Kirk.
That was pretty Regis, yeah.
But she's some serious wishy-washy. And I was disappointed in that because every time she was like, oh, we're going to die. And then Josh Charles is like in her ear saying, you're going to be okay. So I wanted the woman to be successful on her own and take charge, not have the man provide all the answers again. And I'm saying this in the same way it would be the other way around, too. I wouldn't want to be like the guy being like, oh, what are we going to do? And then the woman coming along and patting him on the back and saying, it's going to be fine, dear. So there was that. Any comments first? I'm going to open the floor here. Coco, do you want to say anything?
Well, continue on with your thoughts on this, you know, dynamic, and then I'll jump in. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I had point number two, which I think you might weigh in on as well. Mm-hmm. And so, in space, apparently there's a lot of spare time because in space, Hillary Swank had a lot of time to spend doing two things. So this is point two, but these are points A and B to point two. She had a lot of time to, and I'm going to use this term intentionally, stare out the window and sort of moon gloriously at space and just sort of pine for what had happened and her family and everything like that. She's sitting in her personal quarters and she's looking out the window a lot, or she's emailing her husband, or she's FaceTiming them and her family. And I'm just thinking, don't you have a job to do? Like,
well, and also like, in parts of our house, I can't get a signal.
I wanted to talk about that.
I do agree with your first point, though, because I was actually thinking about that. I'm like, it took them, I believe, 8 months to get from Earth to Mars. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, they're basically at work 24 hours a day for 8 months.
Right.
So I'm like, you know, when you're in space, it's not like you have a desk job and you're done after 8 hours.
Yeah.
Like, if something goes wrong at 3 a.m. when you're all trying to sleep, you gotta figure it out. So
being an astronaut on the mission to Mars is sort of like being a cop or a journalist. Is like you're never really truly off duty.
Or like you're in I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here, or like one of those shows where you're in a house with the cameras on all the time and you just gotta...
Which happens to us, actually, quite a bit with the paparazzi.
That's true. Dalsa was going to try out for Canadian Big Brother, and I pushed him to it, and he didn't want to, so
Big
I was
Brother,
sad
right?
about that.
So... Subpoint to number two about Hillary Swank's character, which is related to the first point that I just made about having a lot of spare time. So apparently a lot of this spare time was taken up by her applying makeup because she had the most crystal clear, beautiful makeup that I've ever seen. And maybe it's super HD. Maybe we're talking 4K or whatever the technology is these days. And you can see every pore on everybody's face. But she had a lot of makeup on. She had a lot of cake on, and a lot of the other characters had cake on, pancake, and not just the women, the men too. So there was a lot of makeup in space.
Yeah, that really, I did mention this to Daltz after like maybe the third episode. I was like, Hillary Swank's makeup is really annoying me because you don't need a smoky eye in space, right? I mean, you don't. I don't understand why they gave her the full makeup treatment. The only thing I can think is either it's a Hollywood production, so that's what everybody gets, and they were just on autopilot, no pun intended, and they just gave her the full makeup treatment just because that's what you do.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe they were trying to make the point that she always had to look put together because they are working. So if this were like a terrestrial office,
mm-hmm.
she would walk in wearing makeup and having her hair done. But because they're in space, she's still the boss. So she's trying to adhere to
societal norms,
to be seen in a position of authority because, in the first like few episodes, something happened at the very beginning of the first episode that caused Lou and Misha to question her authority and question if she's the right person to be the commander.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so maybe they're trying to show that she didn't fall apart. Like she's still looking the part of the boss mm-hmm. in space.
She's still in charge.
Yeah, she's still in charge. But you don't need a smoky eye in space. Like I've seen.
Do you need makeup at all in space?
No, you don't. I don't wear makeup here on Earth because, like I said, I walk dogs and I teach yoga.
Do people need makeup? I mean, my daughters make this point to me all the time when I say you don't need makeup. Men don't wear makeup. Why do women need to wear makeup? And they say, well, you want to look pretty. You want to feel good. It's about you. And I said, okay, well, that's fine. If you want to do it because it's for you, then that's fine. But don't be putting on this mask that society asks you to put on. And men in particular is like, well, women have to wear makeup in order to, for me to be attracted to them. No.
Well, and I've seen plenty of movies and TV shows where obviously the women are wearing makeup, but it's very, very understated. Mm-hmm. Like it's just
subtle.
Yeah, it's just foundation and a little bit of mascara and a little bit of lip gloss. And I feel like if you're going to wear makeup in space, that's probably the way they should have done her.
Right.
Especially because in one episode, somebody comes to her quarters after an incident and she's like baby wiping herself off. So we don't even know if these people are taking showers for 8 months. So I'm like,
probably not.
If you're not taking a shower, how are you having perfect makeup all the time?
Well, and if you're leaving that makeup on and sleeping in it, which I know is not something you should do, then wouldn't your face be riddled with acne after a certain amount of time?
Yeah, especially if you're just like baby wiping it off and then, you know, troweling it right back on.
Well, and then there's, I thought it was pretty hilarious. There's that one scene where I think she was doing a FaceTime with Josh Charles, our boy back on Earth. And he was like, oh, you got all makeup done and you're looking fancy. And I was like, well, how can you tell the difference, man? Like, it's the same.
And she did make the joke. She's like, unlike every other day. And I'm like, that's got to be, like, even though this was clearly filmed months ago, like, that's got to be them being like, yeah, maybe we went down the wrong path with her makeup choices because,
So what else do we want to talk about? Did we explain this in detail enough? I think that's I think I got down to the why I was flabbergasted at their main couple's part in this.
Well, and you going along with what you said, this is basically what you already said, but she is talking to her husband and daughter freaking all the time.
Yeah.
Like I think they talk more than you and I talk.
Right, and we live in the same house.
And we live in the same house.
We live on the same planet.
Right. Like, so that was really annoying. I'm like, you knew that she was going to be gone for 3 years when she signed up for this mission. And one of the things I didn't really especially love is the Josh Charles character really didn't do it for me, kind of pains me to say because I've liked Josh Charles since the Dead Poets Society.
Oh, yeah.
So,
me too.
It pains me to say this, but he was kind of a little bit controlling and kind of jerky.
Yeah.
And, you know, when he, in the very first episode, had a stroke, she was on the moon getting ready to blast off for Mars. And she was like, no, that's it. Like, my husband just had a stroke. I have like a 14-year-old daughter. I can't be away for 3 years. I need to go home to my family. And he couldn't talk, but he had his kid hold the phone up, you know, to his mouth. And he was like, no, go ahead and go.
Yeah.
And but then they spend like the entire rest of the series, him trying to get her to come back. And like Dalt said, she's being all wishy-washy. And she's like, I just want to go home and see my family. And I'm like, you people knew.
Right.
This was a 3-year assignment. You knew that she was going to be gone for this long. Like, I understand it's hard to be away from your family, but this is what you signed up for. Like,
yeah.
I was much more sympathetic to Lou, the Chinese astronaut, who came right out and said, yeah, like, I'm not my child's parent. Like, my husband is my child's parent while I'm here because I'm too far away.
Yeah.
I can't do anything about it. Like, I knew this. I signed up for it. I prepared myself for this. Like, I still love my child. I don't not love my child, but this is the reality of the situation.
She's committed to a job, and she's going to do that job and see it to its end.
Right, exactly. And Hilary Swank was just like, Hilary Swank was kind of annoying me. Like, she was the least compelling of all the astronauts, I thought. Like,
I thought
so,
too.
The other four I liked a lot better, especially Misha and Lou.
Yeah.
Like, I was really annoyed because in the first episode, they set up Misha and Lou to sort of try to, like, mutiny and get Hilary Swank out of there. And I'm like, oh, the Russians and the Chinese, they're the bad guys. Oh, that's really original. But
The communists then, against the capitalists.
Right, exactly. But then their character development over the series, I ended up really liking those characters, and they were very compelling, and the actors did a really good job. And I wanted to see more of Misha and Lou. Like, I thought they were really great.
So. I agree with that. I think also that's a factor of, or an effect of, they had the biggest swing to make because they were the villains to start with.
Right.
And they were really closed off because of the cultures that they're from. The stereotype is that they're not emotional and they're all about the state over the individual and all that sort of stuff. And I agree with that. There's some storylines there that were very compelling and very interesting, and the acting was really good. But I circling back to what you said about Hillary's character, Hilary Swank's character, I agree, and I also I've got to, you've got to think that there's been a lot of psychological testing going on leading up to this mission. And so they're going to be asking questions like, it's almost like she got in there and was like, oh, 3 years?
Right.
Really?
Right. I thought you said 3 months.
Seriously, dude? You know? Yeah. It's like Zac Efron going up. Oh, my mind is blown.
Yeah. Space. Whoa.
Mars, it's right there.
Well, I thought that was a candy bar, man.
So I had trouble really sympathizing with them. And that family just... one disaster after another.
Right.
And the first episode, we had Josh Charles had a stroke.
Yeah.
And then she had some sort of meltdown in space as a result of that. Mm-hmm. And then we had the issue with the rocket, I think, or something like that. And then the first episode was just like all these, you think they would have spread it out a little bit more. They had all these issues. And then the daughter is acting out as you could expect.
I mean,
that would be sort of a logical. She's a teenager and she's having trouble with her mom being gone. Mm-hmm. I can see that.
And then her dad has a stroke, and now she's basically on her own. Like, she's right. Got no parents at all.
She's
got
to be the adult. And, and then one of the astronauts, the member of the team, is sort of like a pseudo-mom to her, like a replacement.
Like a surrogate.
Yeah, thank you. That's a better term. And acting and trying to help out. And she has a daughter, and then they interact like a bit of a family. But I just had really a really tough time believing any of that stuff with the family. And the Josh Charles bit was... absolutely, I agree with that, is that she didn't do anything without his say-so.
Right.
It's like, well, why isn't he in space? Like, I understand why he couldn't be, because, and then get somebody else to go up there. Mm-hmm. So that was an issue for me throughout the entire 10 episodes. I was like, oh, come on already. Make a decision and then just live with it. You're the commander. Like, there were a couple of scenes there where she stood right up and she said, no, this is not happening. And I was like, okay, good. This is what I'm expecting from the commander. You know, she had a James T. Kirk moment. It's like, no, this is what we're doing. We're going and we're doing this and we're landing and you're not talking back to me ever again. And yet the next episode, she was crying about right. something. And it was really troubling. And I will build upon that point about so that this takes place in some sort of nebulous near future. We're not sure when, because it didn't really say.
And it didn't seem a whole lot different from now.
No.
Like, it's all the current model cars and all the
same. And email works the same.
Yeah, it's all the same technology. Everybody's got iPhones.
Right.
You know, it's not like they've got iChips in their brains or whatever.
Right.
Like, so it's today, but we're going to Mars.
Except you can have a cell phone conversation with somebody, you know, light years away in space.
Right.
And have instant conversation. There's no delay. So there, like you said, Coco, there are dead spots in our house where you
totally.
Cannot get a signal.
Right.
And I'm forever talking on the phone and I can hear myself echo on the other end on my cell phone. And they're also, I had a conversation today with somebody and I could tell that they were not hearing me at the same time I was talking. So then that was that was very distracting. And so we have these issues now. So this is some kind of parallel universe that we're in here, where you can go to Mars and you have great cell phone service, but everything else is exactly the same.
I understand that NASA probably has better communications, you know, capabilities than like Frontier or, you know, Comcast or whoever we've got, but you know, that good? Really? Wow.
So... I think we should apply some of that technology to the everyday.
Can I get on the NASA Wi-Fi plan?
Right. Like,
hey NASA. You know?
What's the NASA Wi-Fi password?
Right, totally.
We're driving by the launch pad.
Oh my God, imagine that speed test. Like when you do the speed test, if you've got NASA Wi-Fi, like holy crap.
There'd be smoke coming out of your laptop.
Oh my God, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
No more buffering ever.
So there's some great, speaking of technology in NASA, there's some great MacGyver moves in there that they're trying to do. There is some compelling stuff in there. It gets you from one episode to the other. It feels very much like a TV show to me.
Yeah.
There were a couple of curse words dropped in there every now and then, but nothing, you know, no real nudity, if I recall.
Yeah.
And so it feels like it could have been, you know, on CBS
on
Thursday nights or something like that back in the day when network television was relevant. But I say that in a good way and in a bad way, is that some of the stuff was just like, you know, you could almost hear the laugh track. You know what I mean? Like, in it was almost canned in some ways. Mm-hmm. Laugh track is a bad term to use, because this is not funny at all. As a matter of fact, this is one of the most serious things I think that we've ever watched. And I say that because there are very few light moments along the way. Yeah,
definitely.
And I'm disappointed in that, because Chris Jones, who is my good friend and very good friend, actually, you know, very tight with Chris Jones, he's a very funny guy, and he writes very funny. And that story that he wrote in Esquire was very funny. I mean, how could you lead a story about going to Mars with poop? How do you poop and it not be funny, right? So this series that's one of the things that I was looking forward to seeing, how that all translated onto the screen. And it's not funny at all. Like, the Josh Charles character is one of the most somber SOBs that I've ever seen.
He's now, very dour.
He's got a problem, because he's had a stroke and his wife is, you know, on Mars. And so I get it, but...
And that was the thing that annoyed me too, was, so the other astronaut lady who's like the surrogate mom... Mm-hmm. He is kind of going after her, like in the last episode, for something that happened with the daughter that she didn't tell him about. And he's like, we're in this together, we're a team. And she's like, no, we're not. And I'm like, bro, I know that you got a stroke and you're worried about your wife dying in space, but like, don't push this off on somebody else. Right. Like, this is all you. Like, she's volunteering to help your family out of the goodness of her heart. Mm-hmm. And also, she's in love with you, which I totally called in like episode one.
Yeah, you did.
So, you know, he was just very, I just did not like that character. He was just controlling and, like you said, just very somber and dour. And there was just not really, I didn't get their love story. Like, even in the scenes he and Hilary Swank had together, it didn't, I didn't see like some grand passion there. Mm-hmm. Like, he was always just kind of, he's like that, you know, one jerk that, you know, whatever. And can I just say that she had the worst wig. Like,
in the flashback scenes?
In the flashback scenes, when they were first getting together and she, like, got knocked up, she had the absolute worst wig in the world.
You know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of David Spade and Joe Dirt.
Yes. If it were blonde, she could have been David Spade's twin.
It was like that mullet with the, you know, just the bangs just chopped, right? So you could see.
It was horrible. I don't know. She, whoever is in, like, the hair department, just did her dirty. So I don't know what she did to piss that person off when they were like, here's your wig, you know, for when you're supposed to be 25, but because otherwise she looks exactly the same,
right?
Just in a bad wig.
It was like, to me, it was the equivalent of a flashback with a guy and then you see him and he's got sideburns.
Right,
like, it was just, it was the total, it was the female equivalent of that. It's like, oh, this must be a flashback.
And like, all the digital effects that they did for the spacewalks, right, and the Mars landing, like, you couldn't try to, you know, the Irishman, Josh Charles, and Hilary Swank, and like, de-age them a little bit instead of putting this really horrible wig on her and not doing anything to him at all.
Right.
He looked exactly the same.
He looked exactly the same. He had the same haircut and everything like that.
Totally.
It's like, oh, are we doing the flashback scene today? I guess I'll just put this old shirt on. This plaid jersey on, and then we'll be fine. Meanwhile, she's got to get the wig that looks like it could turn around on top of her head.
Right. Totally. It was horrible.
It was bad.
It was so terrible.
So overall, what did you think of this? What are there other things that you want to talk about?
Well, I'm torn because, well, I will say, before I do like an overall assessment, I thought the girl who played the teen daughter, mm-hmm, Lex, mm-hmm, I actually thought she did a really good job.
So that's Talitha Bateman.
And her boyfriend, the guy who played her boyfriend, I liked him too.
Yeah,
I thought they had a really good storyline. I was all prepared to roll my eyes at like hot teen young love, but like, I kind of bought them. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought they did a really good job. I bought that they cared about each other, and it wasn't just him looking for a handy in the back of his truck.
Handshake,
yeah. So she was believable from the perspective that, like Dalt said, she's, you know, 14, 15 years old. Her mom is gone for 3 years. Her dad just had a stroke. She's basically now on her own. Everything sucks. Like, she's acting out. Like, I really bought her portrayal of that. So I thought she did a good job.
Yeah.
But overall, I'm really kind of torn on this because it could have been more.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was interesting. the non-Hillary Swank related storylines were really compelling.
Yep.
You know, Misha and Lou, and then to a lesser extent, Rom and Kwesi. I didn't think Rom and Kwesi had enough to do. I would have liked to see more of them. And I hope that in season two, because there's clearly going to be a season two,
right?
Even though Netflix, I don't think, has announced it yet. Like, I hope those two have more to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just some like BS, like Rom loves Hillary Swank storyline that they were setting up all season.
Yeah. I'd like to see a lot more of him. I thought we saw enough of Kwesi, from my perspective, but we didn't see enough of Rom. We saw that, you know, his story with the brother and everything like that, but he was a really interesting guy, and he was sort of like he was the physician on board, and he was the co-pilot and everything like that. But he had, I would like to see more of him.
Yeah. So the non-Hillary Swank astronauts, I enjoyed their storylines. But it was just, and they did a good job of building suspense, even though you knew everything was going to be fine.
Right.
Like, you know they're going to land on Mars. Like, nobody's dying. This is not the kind of show where people die, right? You know, it was just, it had a very old-fashioned rah-rah kind of feel to it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said to Daltz after the first episode, you know, at the very end, when the rocket takes off from the moon on the way to Mars, like in the NASA headquarters, like everybody slow-mo stands up and watches like the rocket on the big screen TV. And I'm like, oh God, we've seen this scene 8 million times, the wonder of it all, you know? So it was very old fashioned.
Yeah.
And it was a lot more about like the relationships of people than the technology, even though like technology obviously plays a part, because everything happens in space that can possibly go wrong and they have to solve it. But I don't know. It's just, I was very, very torn.
It, you're right. It was, that struck me as well when I was watching this, is very much not a space show.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's not a lot of shots of the actual spaceship as they're traveling. It's more a human drama. It's more an interaction between the characters.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we have one character who's dealing with a same sex, attraction that is not culturally appropriate, which you can probably figure it out eventually if you watch the show.
I thought that was handled really well.
Yeah, I thought that was really well done.
Mm-hmm.
That was actually, to me, the most heartbreaking of all the stories, because there are a lot of heartbreaking. So another part of this that I just, it rubbed me the wrong way, is that it's really sappy. It's it's really maudlin, and there's a lot of heavy, heavy moments, and I was getting choked up by them, I have to admit, but especially in the last episode. I think there's a crying scene in the last 15 or 20 minutes. Every scene is somebody is crying.
I totally.
And it's hard to take after a while. Like, it's such a serious, hard movie. You know, there's not a lot of humor, like I said, and somebody is crying about something, and at least twice an episode, I would hedge a bet. To say. So it's hard to make it through all that. I hope it has a little bit of a lighter touch in season two. I'm not looking for clowns in space, even though they've got the makeup budget for it.
No kidding.
But I think that it needs to be a little bit lighter. And I agree that the drama was more about the people. And that probably was intentional, because we're not there to watch Ad Astra. We're there to watch Hillary Swank interact with the characters, I guess.
And I mean, they're, you know, in a rocket for 8 months. Like,
right.
it's going to be interpersonal relationships and space stuff.
It's almost like Love Boat. You know, you're trapped with these people.
Love Boat in space.
Love Boat in space.
Angry Space Bojo.
and you've got to make the best of it, because you can't be going to port.
That's all right. Yeah, that's all right.
Remember cruises? Remember those?
No.
No, neither do I.
No.
Which is good. So overall, Coco, I think we need to give a listener an idea whether they should watch this or not. I mean, it's number one in the nation right now.
That's all right.
A lot of people are watching it. It's getting pretty good reviews. I mean, I'd say it's probably getting 75% good reviews, and the rest are panning it for the reasons I think that we mentioned.
Yeah, I've seen a couple middling reviews. I didn't really look for a whole lot of reviews of it. So.
Yeah, I think most of the reviews have been okay.
Mm-hmm.
But it's hugely popular, so the people like it.
And also, like, nothing else has really been released lately.
Right.
So it's a 10-parter, so.
And people are looking for an escape, and very much so, right? It's like, well, this planet's going up in flames. Why don't we watch a show about going to Mars?
Because we've ruined one planet, so why not go trash another?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts?
I would say if I'm going to go back to the letter grades.
Yeah, I know you are.
Yeah.
I was expecting that.
Yeah, I'm sorry I disappoint you.
Yeah, so many ways.
Yeah. I'd give it like a B minus,
yeah,
I'd say.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd give it like I'd give it about a 1.5 dead plants up, because
wow, that's actually really good for you.
Yeah, I maybe 1.25. Maybe you talk me down a little bit if I can go down. Because it held me all the way through.
Yeah.
It held me through all mm-hmm. 10 episodes, which it's been a long time, I think, since we watched a 10 episode series.
Yeah.
And my bum was getting numb at certain points because I was thinking, you know, it's 10 episodes, but the storyline kept me going mm-hmm. and it kept me going through. So now that I think about it more, I'm going to give it one rocket up.
Wow.
You talked me down.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Hillary Swank.
This is live and not rehearsed, listener.
I think they know that if they listen to any of our episodes by now.
So I'm giving it one. So I'd say there are some things coming up this week as we tape this, as we record this, that I'm highly anticipating. I would say if you have something similar that you're highly anticipating, you don't need to rush out and watch away for 10 episodes. But if you're like in a cabin in Maine and you've got your laptop, or actually if you're somewhere in the many countries that we reach now, if you're in India and you're thinking, you know what, I'd like to see how I'm represented, you could watch this.
Yeah.
But I don't think you need to go out of your way. I don't know, what are we talking about Oscars here? Are we anywhere close?
No.
Yeah.
I don't even know if it would be eligible for Oscars
because it's a series,
show. So yeah. Maybe some Emmys. Like maybe some like technical Emmys or whatever,
yeah,
but
yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure somebody's gonna get nominated for acting. Like probably Hillary Swank will get nominated for acting because she gets nominated for everything she does. But
she's good, but this was not her best work, I don't think.
No, like
I mean, Boys Don't Cry. She was amazing in Boys Don't Cry. She was amazing in Million Dollar Baby. This one, she does a lot of crying. Girls cry apparently.
She was amazing in 90210. You know it's true. You know you were a closet 90210 watcher.
I watched a lot of 90210, and it was not my intention. Let's just put it that way. At the time, trying to earn valuable relationship points.
The pre-Coco days.
Right.
Yeah.
I know that's hard to believe that there were some, but...
Well, you've got a couple kids from the pre-Coco days, so... So Dalt's got around a little bit anyway.
Hey, everybody. Hey. Send your cards and letters. Okay, so on that note, Coco, do you want to walk us out of here while I go and apologize to all my fans?
Dear Forum, I never thought it could happen to me.
You'll never guess.
So we are not in the pages of a magazine. We are on podcast platforms.
Right.
You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Pandora, Stitcher, SoundCloud, TuneIn, YouTube, Google Play, Ghana. We are now on Ghana. So if you are in India or have friends or family there, please let them know. We are also on IMDb. Go us. And allegedly, we are on Amazon/Audible. Mm-hmm. So chickadee, check us out if you have an Audible account. If you like the podcast, you want us to review something in the future, you want to give us feedback on a review you've heard previously, give us an email at cocoandalts@gmail.com. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter. Our handle is cocoandalts. Slide into our DMs there. And you can find us on the interwebs at cocoandalts.com, where we review stuff that we don't talk about on the podcast.
And slide by cocoandalts.com, please. And when it says support the podcast, click that button. And it will take you to a magical world where you can send us money.
Because, you know, we'd like to make money off the podcast because we've been doing this for almost 3 years now and we haven't. So
We've got tens of listeners and nope, we appreciate it.
We've got a lot of listeners now that we're big in India.
Actually, we do. We make fun of it, but we're a huge hit right now in parts of the world. And we want to thank you, listener, for, I don't know, traveling the world or sharing and liking and just all around spreading the word about the Coco and Dolls podcast, because we're pretty happy about that, actually.
Sharing is caring.
Sharing is caring. So for another episode of the podcast, the music is playing us out. The director has left, actually. I'm looking over at the booth and the director is gone. So for another episode of the podcast, Coco, I'm not Dolls.
And I'm not Coco. Just leave it in.
And I'm not Coco.
I'm not Dalt. We gotta cut that.
Yeah.